Hello, my friends. I want to tell the truth. In fact, I was going on a date, but on the way, I met a scary werewolf, and he told me to tell a story. My fiancée Alana and I have always been into the occult and paranormal. We're the kind of people who used to fantasize about getting to see a cryptid, or exploring a famous haunted location just for the thrill. I have to be careful about being around too much of the dark energy that some haunted locations have though, since I'm an empath. For anyone not familiar with the term, an empath is defined as a person with the paranormal ability to apprehend the mental or emotional state of another individual. Since childhood, I've learned to manifest my ability, and by now I can absorb emotions from the physical and metaphysical realms. It's a blessing and a curse. Last Tuesday, Alana and I were in the car on our way home from work when our favorite DJ came on the radio. Good evening. This is Mitchell McCarthy on WSK 99.4. And we have a treat for the first person who can call and name this song from the following snippet. This is your last chance to win one of our road trip revelry packages. After a brief pause, the music started playing, and we listened intently. I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful. As it stopped, the radio host came back on. Now, let's see which lucky caller will win this road trip reward. Alana's mom is a huge fan of older music, so we already knew who it was and what the song was. My fiancé immediately dialed the number, not expecting to be the right caller, but she was. I grinned as she correctly blurted out the right answer, silently high-fiving her. Louis Armstrong, What a Wonderful World. The radio host paused dramatically, then he made a drum roll sound with his hands. Ladies and gents, we have a winner. You know what that means, miss, you and two friends have won an all-inclusive road trip to wonderful New Orleans. And you guys will be getting to Louisiana just in time to get some badass. My fiancé got off the phone, grinning from ear to ear. Let's go pick up the tickets, though I know neither one of us is really interested in Mardi Gras. I nodded, thinking about who else we should have tagged along with us. Oh, we should bring Go. He's right along the way, and who said we have to go to Mardi Gras? I'd rather go to the Manchac Swamp, the home of the Rugar. I think the locals call it the Cajun Werewolf. After getting the hotel tickets and the food and gas vouchers, we packed our bags. I made sure to bring a bunch of extra socks, since I've always hated having wet socks on, and then we called up the office and put in our time off. 2 weeks later, we set off on a road trip from northeast Pennsylvania to the Bayou country of Louisiana, and I couldn't remember being more excited for a vacation. The whole ride south, Alana and I discussed our plans for the trip. Neither of us had ever been to Louisiana or thought we ever would, so we had never looked up what things were in the area to do. Upon searching Google rigorously, we finally made a plan for our week in Louisiana, and it couldn't have been more perfect unless we went in October rather than July. Monday we would just relax in the hotel, but we weren't staying in just any hotel. The one the radio prize included was a stay at the Dauphin Orleans Hotel, which was located in the French Quarter. This hotel is rumored to be one of the most haunted hotels in Louisiana, and it complemented the theme of our trip perfectly. Tuesday we would explore the French Quarter and see if we could spot the infamous vampire twins of Louisiana. On Wednesday we would explore the outskirts of the city and try to find old houses that had been abandoned, as well as visiting some of the famous voodoo shops. Thursday we would explore the supposedly haunted St. Vincent's Asylum, which was also located in the French Quarter, and then for the weekend, we would go to the Manchac Swamp and camp. We would search for the Rougar, and for the Voodoo Princess Julie White's cabin that was said to be hidden deep in the Manchac Swamp. As the hours passed, Alana and I would switch off driving through each state, stopping for leg breaks. Finally, 14 hours into the trip, we reached our pit stop for the night. We parked in my best friend Kindera, who we call Co's, driveway in Birmingham, Alabama, and it felt great to be out of the car. It was actually our first time meeting him in person, so it was an emotional moment for all of us. He was overjoyed to see his big bro and big sis, and since he was a fairly large man, he squeezed us into his pillow-like frame with gusto. After telling him about our plan for the week, he was eager to pack some camping gear and to read up about local lore. His tone was zealous, and he quickly gathered what he needed. "I want to see the giant wolfman of Manchac Swamp." That was the last thing he said before we all went to sleep, and after 14 hours of straight driving, my fiancé and I were so exhausted that even the hardwood floor of Co's bedroom felt like a memory foam mattress. The next morning we got up around 8:30 and set off on the last 4 hours of the drive. We were so excited to finally be in the voodoo capital of the US, and right around mid-afternoon, we reached New Orleans. The minute I stepped into the hotel, the energy hit me like a freight train. It made me physically sick for about an hour, and after checking into room number 113, we decided to relax and take a nap. We wanted to spend the night with our EVP and heat cameras trying to find any spirits that were here and to see if they were as bad as they seemed. None of us could sleep well though. I'm not sure if it was because of our excitement, or if something more paranormal was keeping us awake. We ate dinner out and checked out some local attractions, and when the clock hit midnight and we got our equipment unpacked, the EVP meter immediately started going off, worse than at any other place I had been to. Alana and Co nearly shit their pants at the sight of how much energy was in our room, and it definitely explained the feeling I had when I first walked into the building. After 20 minutes of setting up cameras and unpacking equipment, we were ready to explore. As we walked through the empty halls of the hotel, we whispered about how odd it was that such a packed hotel would be so silent in the dead of night. Nearly 45 minutes had passed and nothing was caught on our heat camera, and the EVP device wasn't going off as much as it was initially, so we decided to call it a night since we would have more time to explore in the upcoming days. The next few days passed, and we were all growing restless over the fact that we hadn't seen anything even remotely paranormal yet. The places we picked should have had at least some kind of interesting vibes, but there wasn't anything. Over dinner, on Wednesday night, Alana made a proposal that Co and I readily agreed to. "Babe, can we just cancel the St. Vincent's tour and go to the swamp tomorrow? It seems like all of the drunk, living parties scared anything paranormal off." After she was done talking, I nodded enthusiastically, and Co breathed a sigh of relief. Thank God someone else had the same thought. We set off back to the hotel to check out and gather our stuff. After about an hour of packing, we fit everything back into our car, heading straight to a trailhead near the swamp. Based off all of the legends, this was the part of the swamp that we would be most likely to see the Rougar in or find the alleged still-standing witch's cabin. Since I was the only one who was an avid hunter, I was the only one with a gun, and I made sure to pack my .45 caliber pistol with two full clips of ammo in case of an emergency. It's common knowledge that large snakes and alligators live in the swamps in Louisiana, so we had figured that we would rather have some means of defense than nothing. After walking for what seemed like hours, we finally decided to take a rest. We had just trekked through one of the roughest parts of the swamp trail, so I immediately changed my socks. I figured that we could use the grime-covered ones as fire fuel later in the night if we couldn't find tinder, and I had plenty with me so I wasn't worried. Thankfully it was a warm night in the swamp though, so we didn't need to start a fire at all. The fireflies surrounded us that night, and it was as if there were a million stars. It was literally the most beautiful thing any of us had ever seen, and it was so relaxing that we all were dozing off in our camping chairs. That is until we heard an eardrum bursting howl that sounded like it was right behind us. I took out my pistol and fired a warning shot, and a moment later the grass behind us parted to reveal a scraggly looking man with long, dark hair. "Please, don't shoot me. I wandered into here on accident, and I don't even know where here is. I heard you guys talking and thought you might know the way out." My fiancé, being the caring person she is, paid no mind to the fact that his clothing was torn up and he looked a little unhinged. She invited him to sit with us and even got him a granola bar. After about 10 uncomfortable minutes, I finally spoke up. "So, why are your clothes torn up?" He gave a vague response about how the swampy can beat you up, but he didn't go into detail. I once again tried to get some information out of our strange visitor, though his heavy Cajun accent was a little hard to understand. "Did you see the thing that made that horrendous howl?" He shifted a little, and I could tell he wasn't feeling very comfortable with my questions. He finally replied, after thinking about his response carefully. "Boy, you can call me Jack. Now that we're all friends here. There is no need to worry, I can assure you I'm not one of those beasts. In fact, that howl is what scared me into coming here. I don't know how I got here, though I'm assuming I was drunk after the last week of Mardi Gras." I looked at Ko as if to give him an "I don't trust him" completely look. Ko immediately returned the look, but we continued to chat amicably. We gave Jack an extra sleeping bag and told him that he was welcome to sleep in one of the chairs. We said we would show him the way out in the morning since it was too dangerous to travel in the swamp at night, which he readily agreed to. The next morning we all arose to find Jack was missing. I looked at Alana and shook my head. "Still trust him? You and I both know he had very odd energy." She sighed and just looked down, knowing I was right. We packed our gear up, hiking further into the swamp. The next few hours went fast, and the heat was blistering. We all just wanted to relax in the water, but even we knew it wasn't wise to swim in bayou water. A few hours later we finally saw a broken down shack in the middle of the swamp, and we got excited. What if this was the cabin of the voodoo princess? The shack had been left untouched for a long time since there was moss growing on everything. We made our way inside the building and were immediately weirded out. Laying in the floor was a little hand-sewn doll, and it looked exactly like Jack. We decided to set up camp for the night but made sure we got well away from the shack. That night was a bit chillier, so we made a fire. We were telling scary stories around it when we again heard a loud howl. No sooner had I put my gun in my hands when Jack came walking out of the swamp. "Friends, we meet again. I'm sorry I left so unexpectedly this morning. A big snake chased me off, and then I got lost until I saw the fire. Mind if I stay with you again tonight?" We hesitated, but we didn't want him to get hurt out there, so we agreed. He smiled and thanked us again, and the hours passed quickly as we ate and chatted until we got sleepy. The next morning the same thing happened. Jack had vanished again, leaving us all extremely concerned. I had decided that if we saw him again tonight I would stay awake until morning to see where he kept going. We hiked back out of the swamp, double timing it to cover more ground than our previous, unhurried pace. We had not seen anything out of the normal, other than that doll and Jack, but we had still had fun. We got back to the first campsite relatively fast, though we were all exhausted by then. After setting up camp, I told Ko and Alana my plan for the night in case Jack came back, and Ko decided he would be staying up with me because he didn't want to risk me getting harmed. Once again we heard the howl after sunset, and as expected Jack came walking out of the swamp behind us right after. We all exchanged a look and welcomed him back as though nothing had happened. A few hours later Alana fell asleep, and so did Ko despite him saying he would stay up. He finally passed out, and I pretended to while still keeping an eye on Jack. I must have dozed off at some point because when I opened my eyes the fire was out and Jack was heading into a nearby clump of bushes. I got up and followed him, trying to see where he went in the dim moonlight. "Jack, where are you going?" His response was not what I expected. Instead of hearing him shout back, I heard the howl again, but this time it was behind me. As I turned around slowly I saw it, the Rugar. It was a large, almost humanoid white wolf with the most blood-red eyes I had ever seen. I'm ashamed to admit it, but I was terrified and I blacked out. Upon waking I jumped up and looked around, terrified because I was still somewhere in the swamp with that thing. Dawn was just showing, and I stumbled back to camp. I could hear Alana and Ko shouting to me from the distance, and I hurried back to them. They looked worried sick, and we were relieved to be back together. We figured I must have had a night terror, which I was known for, and I must have sleepwalked out of camp. We made our way out of the swamp and back to our car, and after packing up quickly we headed out of Louisiana and back towards Ko's house. On our way home, however, I felt different. I was more hungry than normal, and as I looked into the mirror my normally hazel eyes did something I had never seen before. They flashed blood red, just like that monster I had seen last night.